Welcome, everybody, on this fine Californian sunny day. Happy New Year to everybody, because this is the first episode of 2022, episode 44 of the West Coast Jazz Hour. And of course, I would like to welcome my good friend and partner in crime and co-host Josh Nelson. And for today, we have a very special guest. He's an amazing musician, trombone player, educator, and also he's a very sweet and funny cat. Let me see. He has played with the bands of Maynard Ferguson, Woody Herman. He's currently principal trombone player of the Long Beach Symphony, and he has played with the LA Phil, Hollywood Bowl Orchestra, and Los Angeles Chamber Orchestra. And he has also performed with people such as Ray Charles, Henry Mancini, John Williams, Danny Elfman, Johnny Mandel, and many more. And he's one of the original members of the Gordon Goodwin Big Fat Band, and he's also currently a member of the Tom Kubis Big Band. And I can go on and on and on about this guy. Today we welcome Alex Iles to the show. Welcome, Alex. Nice to see you.
Good to see you guys. I'm a big fan of this whole concept and the whole show that you guys have put together, and it's thrill. I'm really honored that you asked me to be a part of it. Thank you so much for letting me blab and tell lies for a little while.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thanks for being here. Usually when we have a guest, we'll start off with the same question that we ask every guest, because you grew up here in SoCal, so we would like to know, how did you work yourself into the LA scene, or the West Coast scene, or however scene you want to call it?
Sure. Well, thanks. I grew up in Southern California. I grew up in Arcadia, California, which is just out just west or east of Pasadena, California. And a very non-jazz oriented area for the most part back then when I was growing up. I was part of the public music program. I learned to play trombone in the public school system, which was really good. We had an excellent public music program and great teachers. And got us going, and we had a really good high school music program with a great marching band and all that kind of stuff. So I always felt music was a big part of my life, even without thinking in terms of professionally. It was just something we all did. It was kind of our we worked our and ex exuded our school spirit through music. And so that was a lot of fun. I'd been really active in sports when I was much younger, and then that was sort of replaced with music in a lot of ways as my primary activity. So I didn't really study privately in school too much. We had good instruction, and I got the basics from my teachers in public school. I really got into music kind of as a listener, which I think is almost like a parallel existence, because we didn't have jazz readily available. I sort of raided my dad's record collection, and he was not necessarily specifically a jazz fan, but he had lots of records. He had a bunch of Ellington records, and he had Henry Mancini records and lots of easy listening instrumental things. So I got to hear musicians playing in lots of different styles and different idioms. And he also had and he had the Benny Goodman story and the Glenn Miller story and all those kinds of records. So I had a exposure to big band music very early, and I always loved it, but I didn't really have too much opportunity outside of listening. And I listened, as we were just talking about before we went on on a live here. We had a great jazz radio station in Los Angeles, which I found, and I learned about names and groups from that. And I started listening. And also, we had a college jazz band come and play a concert for us from I think it was a college from Chaffey College, and they played all different kinds of music. But the tunes that stuck in my head, it was a modern instrumental big band. And the tunes that stuck in my head had the weirdest titles. So I was about 13, and I told my dad, I said, I want to buy a jazz record, but I don't know where to start. He's like, well, what did you like about the concert today? I said, all the tunes with the weird titles. I loved them, you know? So I went to the record store with my dad, and he said, go ahead, pick a record. So I'm looking through a Charlie Parker. I don't know who that is. Bill Evans. Who's that? I don't know. So I finally came across an album with this picture of this band in what looked like a rock and roll setting. It was like big lights, and guys were dancing around and wearing, had long hair, and they looked kind of like rock and roll people. And I looked at the record, and there was a title. One of the tunes was "The Magic Bus Ate My Donut." And that was Don Ellis live at Fillmore. So that was my
I was gonna say Don Ellis.
That was the first jazz album I bought, and that kind of
Wow.
put me off in a very strange direction. And I
Yeah.
loved it. It was great, but it was through that that I it was that was kind of my portal. And between that and like a lot of the other kids, we were listening to Maynard Ferguson and all those sorts of bands, and I became a fan of the Woody Herman Band from afar because they always had. To me, they always had like this lineage of great trombonists, and so I sort of listened to all those big band recordings, with going back to Bill Harris and Herbie Green, all the way up to the modern players at that time, which was Jim Pugh, was a big influence on me when I used to hear him live, and so I got to listen to that band quite a bit, and I became a big Woody Herman fan, and then I sort of that got into other things and started reading books about jazz and sort of taught myself, and by the time I got to college, I was really interested in it, and there were opportunities to start to play a little bit, so that's when I started playing, and we used to start going to concerts more in earnest. When I was still in high school, my old dear friend Sal Lozano, he and I sort of started discovering this music together, and we didn't have a place to play, but we could go to Eagle Rock High School. Eagle Rock High School had live concerts. You guys have probably talked about that with some of your other guests.
Yeah, a
They
little
had a
bit.
concert last the second Sunday of every month. They would have the high school jazz band would play, which was an amazing jazz band. Dave Stone, late bass player, went to Eagle Rock. Carlos Vega, the drummer, also went
Oh,
to
yeah.
Eagle Rock High. There's still players around that went to Eagle Rock. It was a great band, way ahead of the curve. And they'd have the high school band would play the first half, and then the second half would be a jam session with local great West Coast players. We'd hear Jack Sheldon, Dolo Coker. We'd hear, let's see, who else played there a lot? Buddy Collette played there, and we heard. The trombonists were always great. We had Frank Rossolino would come play, and people like that. I mean, it was just, and they just play tunes, and it was just so fun to hear. That was my first exposure to what a jam session was, and at that level, you know, it was
Wow.
spectacular. So one thing as a side note, Dave Stone acquired all those recordings.
Whoa.
And he was in the process of going through them the last 20 years. He was going through all these recordings. I would somebody should get a hold of his family.
Yeah.
See if there's a way to continue that project that he had started, because there's some great stuff in there.
I'm sure.
Performances by people that are no longer with us that Blue Mitchell played, and it was just a ridiculous experience. And we didn't even realize how great it was at the time. It was like $1 for students to go to this thing.
Wow.
It was so fun. Anyway, we always tried to go there, and that's when I started really listening and learning about the whole West Coast jazz that existed here. And so that was it. And then when I went to college, I just continued that. And I started playing a little bit of jazz and learning about it. And went to the Aspen School of Music a couple summers and was kind of doing, I was there at a jazz fellowship. And that was through my jazz band director at the time, Gary Gray, who was a studio clarinetist. Also, he just passed away recently, which is very sad. He was a great teacher and great clarinetist. And he ran the jazz band and basically offered me a scholarship because he's like, I don't want to listen to a bunch of demo tapes. Can you come to Aspen? I said, great, okay. Mm-hmm. So I went to Aspen a couple summers and played on a complete free ride to go there. I mean, it was a huge privilege and an opportunity. So, and I studied jazz a little bit with a guy, you might know him, Josh. His name was, give me a second, Vince Lawrence Maggio. Did you know Vince Maggio?
No, can't say I did.
He was kind of the jazz guru down at University of Miami.
Oh.
He taught everybody who went to school there, and he was a wonderful pianist. He toured for a while with Phil Woods, and he was a beautiful jazz pianist.
I'm not familiar. I'll have to look him up.
Yeah, and he was great. He gave me some of the basics and was critical, you know, really made great comments about all of us, you know, playing and how to help us with get started, basically, with playing jazz. So that was a really good opportunity. And then after that, I just kept going and started doing rehearsal bands a little bit, started studying trombone with Roy Main, who was a wonderful teacher and freelance trombonist in L.A., also a nice jazz player. And then after that, I just started doing bands and sort of picking my way through things. And I was living at home with my parents, and then I got a call to work on a cruise ship for a while. Mm. And I did that and learned a lot about playing casual work. And then played a lot more jazz there, and just improvising, playing lots of things by ear. Just it was my ear training for 6 months. Mm. And then I got an opportunity. A friend of mine named Dan Levine, who's a trombonist in New York, mentioned to me that they were looking for a trombone player for Maynard. And so I made a little recording and sent it to Steve Wiest, who was the trombonist at the time, who's now a good friend, and to Maynard's management. And so they offered me the spot to go tour with him. And I toured with Maynard for just about 2 years. and off and on. And then after that, I Maynard cut down to a smaller group. He started this band called High Voltage, which was just him and one horn player. So the horn section was kind of laid off. So I went out again. I went out with Woody Herman's band, and I toured with them for a year, and that was great. That was sort of my dream. You know, it's like getting to play baseball with the Yankees. You know, it was great. I was really happy that I got to do that. And
who were some of the people who were with you in the band?
In band, well, in Maynard's band, they were a great lineup of the horn players were Wayne Bergeron, myself. Pete Olstead toured for a while with Maynard too. And we also, Alan Wise, who was a longtime member of the group, he was in the trumpet section. Rick Margitza was the tenor player.
Yeah.
Tim Reese was a saxophonist. So it was a killer.
Wow.
Horn section and jazz musicians on a level that I hadn't been around, especially getting to play with the other horn players, Tim and Rick. They were a huge influence on me. Just to listen to them practice was, oh my, what have I not been doing the last 10 years? Wow. So they were a real big influence on me. And, I just loved their whole musical approach. It was really very interesting. And then out on Woody's band, we had some great players. John Allred was the other tenor trombonist, who is one of my favorite jazz trombonists ever.
Great.
He lived out here for a little while before he moved to New York. That's a good example of someone who is not applicable to any coast in my mind. He's born in the South, lived in Florida, worked in Florida, then he came to L.A., and then he moved to New York. He's beyond category, and he's just one of the most incredibly swinging, melodic jazz trombonists, I think. And
sure is.
He's one of my absolute favorites, and it was fun to hear him play every night, and also made you want to quit. and then Charlie Pillow, who plays in Maria Schneider's band for a long time, he's an East Coast New York session player as well. He's a wonderful doubler, but he's a beautiful composer and tenor sax player, Charlie Pillow. He just recorded a small big band record, I believe. I'm thinking off the top of my head, which is never a good idea, but Charlie's gone on to a very successful life in New York as a jazz musician. Greg Gisbert, who's a wonderful jazz trumpet player. He was one of the
wonderful.
The other jazz trumpet was Ron Stout. I mean, those two guys. Wow. That was a great juxtaposition. Roger Ingram was playing lead trumpet. Also, Eric Miyashiro was playing lead trumpet. So we had some really great players that went on to do lots of interesting things after Woody's band, as Woody's band always has been that way. You know, it's really.
Did you make recordings with
Woody's
band?
No, I never did. I was in between. I came on right after they'd released an album, which is the 50th anniversary album, I believe.
Yeah, yeah.
And I came in replacing John Fedchuk, which was those two.
Yeah.
They left, and they'd been there a long time, and they were an institution on Woody's band there. It was they were such great, solid players. So John and I came in. It was a lot of fun, but it was big shoes to fill. And John, because he was the primary musical director of the band and chief arranger, and so he was kind of the cat daddy of that band for a long time. but he's fantastic and doing great things in New York, obviously. And that was, and then when I came back to LA, that's when I sort of started working at Disneyland, which was, strangely enough, a great area, a great place to learn about playing as a professional, because there were lots of good players. Eric Marienthal, Sal Lozano, Andy Martin, Charlie Marillis, Wayne. I mean, it was a great group of musicians. Joey Sellers was working there then, too. So it was a really nice musical environment, despite the fact we were all wearing funny clothes and playing some nice stuff. But I think what's great about, you know, places like Las Vegas or Disneyland or even other Broadway pits, you know, you get these musicians that are in situations that are not maybe the most musically rewarding in every way, but people figure out what to do to make it work, and they figure out ways to supplement what they're doing with other kinds of music to keep them sane or more insane, however you look at it. And I Disneyland was great. I feel like I did my graduate work at Disneyland about how to be a freelance player and opportunities to play music. You know, that's the Tom Kubis band formed largely out of the group of players that came from that world. And so that was one band that sort of emerged out of that world. A lot of ways, this is the Gordon Goodwin band, similar too. Gordon was a Disney alum. And so we all kind of had that shared experience, which I think sort of helped make that music much more alive, you know, as a contrast. I don't want to diss Disney, because I'm still responsible for a lot of my income these days, so I don't wanna... But it was a great experience. I loved working down there at the time. It was a perfect time in my life. You know, you're in your 20s and you get to play your horn every day for a stretch of time. There's nothing better, and you get some great stories out of it. So, and so then after that, I just started freelancing more. And then around 89 or so, I started getting back into playing orchestral music, and I started focusing on that, practicing it, studying. I studied with Ralph Sauer for a while from the LA Philharmonic, and then I started pursuing that as well as sort of this jazz commercial world that I'd been a part of. And that I just was interested in it, and I always loved it, and I sort of neglected it. So I got back into it, and I took an audition with Pacific Symphony, which is an orchestra that plays in Orange County.
Yeah.
And I didn't win, but I kind of made it through a couple rounds, and I was, and so as a result, it sort of put me in the mix with players to sub. And so that's when I started doing more of that kind of playing, and it was great. You know, I'd do some pops concerts and maybe extra on some pieces with large trombone sections and stuff. And and then I went to a seminar in 2000 in New York, given by Joe Alessi, who's a principal trombonist with the New York Phil. And that really helped me a lot to get even more intense. And it was mainly by the other players. I just turned 40, and it was kind of my midlife crisis present. And so I went there it was a 7-day workshop, and all the players there were in their mid-20s, hungry, right out of graduate school, or just won their first regional orchestra jobs, and they were looking to up their game, you know, to go to the next level. And they, as much as Joe did, he pushed us all, but the other players were really inspiring. And so that made me really sort of focus on that. And then I won the job with the Long Beach, is right after that. So that really helped me in terms of studio work, because I'd been doing a fair amount, but once I sort of got that, that people saw that I'd been, you know, become more comfortable in that world. Sometimes the music heads that direction in the studios. Sometimes they think it heads that direction. So it's nice to, for contractors and composers and stuff to kind of know that you're comfortable doing that kind of music, because it's a lot different kind of equipment. We play different instruments. It's a different approach and sound. So because I've sort of been doing more of that, I think it was, you know, like, I guess he's okay for this. So that helped me a lot professionally. And I really didn't have any eyes to apply that knowledge. I just loved that music so much. I was getting back into it, but it had a nice byproduct to it. So
yeah.
And having come to it late, it's fun for me to teach, because it's more fresh in my head. In a lot of ways. So I'm still a newbie. I consider myself a newbie when it comes to playing in an orchestra, but it's something I do love to do, and I have a lot of more appreciation for it now. I also appreciate the fact that I didn't focus on that specifically when I was younger, because I think, especially living in Los Angeles and being a freelance musician in a big city, it's kind of helpful to have different interests and lots of different things that you are comfortable in musically. So, and I had to really pay dues in everything I did, from playing casuals to playing in a traditional jazz band, you know, like playing old, you know, old style Dixieland music and all that kind of stuff. I had to spend a lot of time learning that. I spent a lot of time learning how to play salsa. You know, that's a great skill set to have, and it's totally different than playing in a big band, for instance, or something. So all these experiences growing up in LA, I had great opportunities, and the level of any kind of music you can mention, the level out in this area and other places too. It's not just here, but in Los Angeles, there happens to be a great influx of great musicians who are maybe more specialized, and you can learn and get your butt kicked and really have to adjust. But you know, the musicians I get to work with on a regular basis are just so spectacular. I just walk away from work sometimes just shaking my head at the level of skill and talent that's in this city. You know, and it's been inspiring to me, even going back to those Eagle Rock days. That was that's where it really kind of started. So
that's a great feeling to have, to leave a session or leave a gig and be totally inspired.
Oh yeah, it's a rehearsal band at the Union with your band.
Oh yeah,
same thing. You know, I hear some of these younger players, you know, that are just killing it. You know, it's so exciting that the whole tradition of music in this city is just, it's as good as it's ever been, as in my mind. It's in a great place. So.
That's great to hear. That's especially from somebody who's seasoned like you to say that about the scene, that it's in, you know, good hands.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Kevin. I'm sorry. I'm glad you used seasoned. That's very respectful.
My pleasure.
Lightly marinated.
Welcome to the West Coast Comedy Hour, ladies and gentlemen.
Salazano, if you're watching, chime in, please.
Yeah. Well, I saw that Francisco is here, so Francisco is
talking about it. Yeah, that there's a cat with
Francisco. I went to Long Beach State with Francisco for my undergrad, and he was a very pivotal part of me learning tunes in the beginning, and he would challenge me, and major influence on me, that guy.
Absolutely. It was on me. He actually studied with me. I took over from my teacher.
Okay.
And he studied I don't know what I taught him, because it's like he was pretty ready. You know, so he just, that's all he needed was a little seasoning. So he and you know, as a lot of people know him, of course, a fantastic trombonist. My chair took it over, and on Gordon's band, he kills it. And what a writer. I mean, that's the thing with Francisco. He's got so many great musical skills. He's awesome.
Yes, he is.
Big fixture now. I think he's I have a lot of respect for him as a musician. Boy, he's great.
Absolutely.
And I love to sub for him once in a while on Poncho. That's once in a while. I know there's a few of us that sometimes fill in for him, because he gets so busy. He's such a big star now. And so he can't do all the Poncho gigs. So once in a while I get to fill in for him. And that's, oh man, that's a humbling experience, but really fun. I love doing it. Anyway. Another thing.
That's enough nice words about Francisco. We got to keep him humble.
We were saying all those lousy things about him before we got on.
And listen to some music, because this was a really nice overview that you gave us, Alex.
Thank you.
About your career. It was super cool. It's all good. It's your show, baby. So
yeah.
So you gave a bunch of recordings that you're on, but also recordings that have inspired you. So maybe it's cool to start out with something that has inspired you. So whatever you prefer. I have the list right in front of me, so can basically put up what you want.
Why don't you jump right into that Don Ellis thing.
So this snap.
Explains a lot about me. And this is that bulge? Do you have that handy?
What's that? The Don Ellis.
Do you have anything queued up?
So it's let's see, Don Ellis right here. And it's the Bulgarian Bulge, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
His wildest tune to me. And
yeah, that's wild. Yeah. Great call.
Yep.
I love this.
You know, think West Coast jazz, you think of something a little different than this, but sorry, this was my...
No, this is great. You know, that's funny you mentioned, this was a very, you know, Electric Bath, that Don Ellis record was my first introduction to big band music, because our director at Long Beach State, Neil Finn, you probably know who that is, he was a huge Ellis fan. So I was like, wow, this music's crazy. What is this? Yeah. Anyway.
But okay. This is a good example also of how what you also mentioned in the before we actually went live, about that West Coast has a certain type of stamp on it that came from the critics, which I totally agree with you, but that there's some of the hippest music that's out there was also made out here, and Don Ellis is one of those people who was really progressive in making that music. And I remember the interview that we did a little while ago with Peter Erskine. He showed something also from Don Ellis. I believe that was Indian Lady. Yeah, with Ralph Humphrey on drums and two bass players. Oh my God.
On this, on Bulgarian Bulge at Fillmore, and I think on Tears of Joy and maybe a couple of the other records, he had two drummers, and then he went, and they had these drum bits they would do with the three of them. It was crazy.
Yeah. He was, but still that it is sort of a cacophony, but still structured in some way.
Yeah. They ruined it. They kind of worked it out. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. All right. Well, this is a 5-minute track, so we can just, listen to this for sure.
Cool.
So here we go with Bulgarian Bulge by Don Ellis. Here we go. We'll be right back.
gotta practice. Steve Melcho.
It's so fun. When I started getting into the freelance scene, I started running into players that had played with Don Ellis around that era, in the early 70s and even the late 60s. Some of the people that played in his first bands, like the Live in 3 3/4 band. It was just an early band, which was funny because it was made up of a lot of people who were out of the big band era playing this music. It was kind of crazy. Anyway, but talking to the players about the way Don would kind of organize his band or not organize it. You literally never knew what to expect with him. He would write a sax solo, like he'd be in backstage before the gig finishing, writing out a sax solo he's going to insert on a tune. Or it was great. I mean, it was the whole thing was a spontaneous event every time they played, and he would count off tunes at new tempos. He would add solos. I mean, it was great, and it was on a lot of times on live recordings. He would just change things up. You never knew what to expect with him. And it's wild, you know. There's a couple of his former players. I mean, Alan Kaplan, of course, played with him in the 70s, and Fred Zeldin, who actually wrote that tune that I bought that record for, which is "The Magic Bus Ate My Donut." You know, that was actually Fred Zeldin's arrangement. Don was always good about playing music by other people. Of course, he played a lot of Hank Levy, and people who also were into the whole multimeter thing that he was so into. But that was a tune. I think the Bulgarian Bulge is credited as Don's. It might be credited as Don's tune, but actually, it was a tune that Milcho taught him, because Milcho, I mean, that's his music.
It's oh my gosh.
That Balkan crazy folk music. And I remember on the liner notes something about, like, you know, for Milcho to play in a tune like that, which is whatever, in 33, or I don't even know what meter it's in, but for him to play on that, it's like playing 4/4 blues for anybody.
Incredible.
Else. Yeah, I know. People dance to that music in the Balkans. They dance to it. So it's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it was quite an education for me to learn, you know, sort of be exposed to that stuff, and it was great. But to hear I learned a lot about sight reading talking about some of the former players with that band, because they said this stuff was so hard, and they were constantly playing new tunes, and that's what I learned the lesson that from one of the former trombonists who used to play with Ernie Carlson. He said, with multimeter, you take one beat at a time. Forget whether it's 33 or 7 or 12, it doesn't matter. One beat at a time.
That's great advice. Solid advice. Yeah. Wow. I'm awake now. I wasn't before this tune. But I'm awake.
It's kind of shocking for a 13-year-old kid who's new to jazz to hear that. But
I
loved it. You know, it's great.
Yeah. Shocking for me.
I love those fills on the shout chorus. Those fills. I guess it's Ralph playing drums.
Is it Ralph?
I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah.
So I have to double check. But that little stutter moment. It was just that little bit of space and everything. Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, here we are, ladies and gentlemen. Super cool. What do you want to continue with?
I mean, we could play. I was a member of Bob Florence's band for about 15
years. Yeah, I got a nice record behind me of the Florence bands.
I heard the band at Carmel's many times.
I'm jealous.
That's another band I used to hear. It just like, God, this is what a sound. That band was
a
great band out front to listen to. It had such a marvelous balance to it. Big, you know, it had six. He always had six saxes and five trumpets.
Yeah,
but it was always controlled. The players always played with control. And particularly the person who's a big one of my biggest influences musically was the lead trombonist with Bob Florence for years. It was Charlie Loper.
Who's, yeah, Charlie.
He's still playing great. And his sound and approach on that band was so distinct. And I think I'm not alone just as a trombonist saying this, people in the band and also people listening would say that a lot of the time the ensemble feel came from him. It was interesting that inner voice, you know, that usually is just the last trumpet, you know, going down the line, but his phrasing and his feel and his pitch and everything, all the details was just so perfect all the time. You know, I sat next to him for all those years, for 15 years. And I've learned so much from Charlie, just the way he addresses the music and approaches the music. It was always so clear. And we all marveled at him. All the other trombonists coming up, we'd always go, God, how does Charlie do that? How can everybody play the same parts that, you know, we all play the same parts in different bands. Charlie plays it and it's like, forget it. That's it. That's what it should sound like. And he's just a class act. He's like a really perfect luxury car, you know, and you just sit there and you're just like, why am I driving a Toyota Corolla? I mean, I could have this. He's just a marvelous, marvelous musician. Yeah.
Yeah. He's on so many recordings. He's on this.
And in lots of
shit. Yeah.
Totally comfortable. Nice jazz player. Very.
Oh yeah.
Influenced player. He loves JJ Johnson. And just, we had this inside joke where we'd be on a break in a rehearsal and he'll just go, just play a little JJ Lick and I'll go, we just have a conversation back and forth. Not say a word, just play.
That's cool.
Yeah, I got to play.
Go ahead, Josh.
Oh, I was just in Mike Barone's band in the early 2000s, and Charlie, I remember hearing his sound and just how beautiful the trombone sections. Oh, yeah. Now, of course, Mike being a trombonist,
yeah,
I think he just curated the book. Like, it was Bill Booth and Charlie, and I was like, wow, it sounds like one player.
those are two of the best sounds you're ever going to hear.
Oh man, yeah. I was spoiled. I was like,
both those gentlemen are huge influence on so many of us
here. Oh man,
you know, I was just always in awe of that thing, that sound, and that's,
yeah,
something. One of the distinctive qualities maybe about the West Coast thing is players, because we're involved in recording in such an intimate way, either in TV, film, or recordings, sound recordings, that sound really stands out when it's right. And
right.
Charlie has an approach to the lead trombone that I've always loved, because it's never a strident thing. That a lot of people who play lead trombone in a big band, they get kind of into a strident, sometimes they try to put too much affect in the playing, which, you know, you have to do once in a while, but sometimes they do it in area in situations. Charlie just knows exactly how much spin to put on a phrase, like just a little bit of a slide thing. You just go, oh, that's exactly right. It was always subtle, and it's always this very, it's very engaging when it's subtle. You know, it's not over the top. He just knows exactly how much nuance to put on something. It's very innate. It's his personality, I think, a lot of it too. But he's always been a huge model for all of us to play lead trombone, especially. And you know, the school of lead trombone playing, sometimes I hear among even some other professionals, I go, God, what? Why are they doing? They're going all this effort to try to make something happen, and it's not necessary. It's just you just have to listen to Charlie or Bill. Bill's another great example. It's just being able to put enough on a phrase to be able to make it work. Anyway,
As you know,
I mean, when I first heard him with Toshiko's band, actually, play that.
Toshiko.
Well, man, I checked out that track, and that is the shit. Excuse my language, but that's the shit.
Yeah. Yeah. That band was a huge influence on all of us here in Los Angeles.
This is a record from Toshiko too.
Yeah.
It almost knocked me off my chair, literally.
That's the first one I got, was Tales of
Oh Rock. Yeah?
Yeah. But the thing about that band, you know, Bobby Shue playing lead trumpet and jazz. I mean, you have one of the greatest jazz players in the world playing lead trumpet on a band like that. It's hard to beat. Steve Hufstetter was in the band. I mean, it was great. And the saxophone section with Gary Foster on lead alto, which is another person. Talk about sound. What a unique, beautiful sound he's always had. And Lou, the crazy, you know, off the wall madman of a tenor sax player, just his solos would be just astounding every time I went to hear him play. But I think in this track, and also we know him mostly as a bass trombonist, but Bill Reichenbach playing an incredible jazz trombone solo on this tune on tenor trombone. He's an underrated tenor trombone player.
Yeah.
By himself. That's the thing that gets me. He sort of talks down his tenor trombone playing. Bill's a fantastic tenor trombone player. And he plays jazz on it, on that March of the Tadpoles that I sent you, that one, which was written for basically for the trombone section. And
yeah,
it's so good with Phil Teal, Rick Culver, Phil Teal on bass, Rick Culver, Bill, and on lead. And that to me is one of the greatest examples of lead trombone playing ever.
Yeah. So good. Rick Culver is not on this one. It's Britt Woodman.
Britt Woodman, right.
Yeah.
Right.
But to have Reichenbach and Phil Teal in one section, plus Charlie.
It's pretty good. Britt plays a beautiful solo on that record, too. He plays a very good jazz solo on that particular Tosca record. I love Britt Woman.
Yeah.
Well, we had another sidetrack, of course. If you're talking to me, you're going to get sidetracked.
It's okay.
All good.
People don't realize in Los Angeles, we had a lot of Duke Ellington alums living here.
Yeah.
Britt Woodman, Bob Cooper, Lawrence Brown lived here. His life ended here in Los Angeles. He was a big part of the Musicians Union. He was an officer with the Musicians Union for many years. Lawrence Brown, I mean, these were incredible players that settled here. And Britt was fantastic. I heard him at one of the Eagle Rock concerts too. Benny Powell, another.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah.
And then, of course, you know, you had all these great players from all the different bands, the Basie band as well, and Kenton's band, of course, from the 50s and 60s. So it was just this tributary, you know, that would come here. Yeah,
that's a nice way of putting it.
I want to hear it now. We've been talking about March the Tadpoles. We listen to that because
Kenton's
solo is incredible, and then Bill's solo, and the trombones are featured in a soli that's just mind-boggling. And it's a up-tempo version of All the Things You Are.
Yeah, exactly. It's a contrafact. Yeah.
You don't go away humming this tune, but
you know the changes to All the Things You Are.
It'd be a lot of a Lenny Tristano kind of tune.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But because Toshiko's writing is also it is kind of Tristano-ish.
Which is, I think, is one of the things that's sort of associated a lot with the West Coast kind of approach in the 60s, especially when you think of people like Lee Konitz, who was a big Tristano devotee, and some of the players, although Tristano was a New York person.
Right.
Yeah.
But for some reason, that approach influenced a lot of the musicians.
Absolutely.
That label.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, that's a good definitely.
Point. Well, let's take a listen to the Toshiko Akiyoshi and Lou Tabakin Big Band.
Live at Newport.
Live at Newport, yes, number 2. Check that out. And the title of the song is March of the Tadpoles. Yep. I'm going to start it off properly. So here we go. Hold on to your horses, ladies and gentlemen. March of the Tadpoles. Here we go.
Thank you.
My goodness.
Man.
That band was on fire.
Oh man.
They were also into it. That was the thing. I mean, they occasionally, I guess Toshiko would bring these charts in and they'd look at them and go, are you serious? And then sort of like break the ice with them and go, oh, okay, that's what this is about.
Right.
You know, it's not music that's meant to be sight read on the gig.
No.
Although I do know some people that did that. That's always interesting. But yeah, that line that where she writes a whole soli, that builds up to the full ensemble, that she loved that color of like a muted trumpet, a couple woodwinds, like a clarinet and a flute, and a bass trombone along for the ride. Yeah. It's just insane. And yeah, she loved doing that stuff. She did that on Road Time Shuffle Tune. There's a like that. Anyway, I just love that. You know, Phil had to bust his chops on that trombone solo, and then he has to come in and do that other solo after it. It's great.
Damn. Yeah. I mean, that's some of the best trombone ensemble work I've ever heard.
Yeah, it's really spectacular. He and Charlie just sounds so easy. And what as a trombonist, and I'm listening to that, just his turns, just going, de-da-da. It's like everything's just so in time and so beautiful and shaded, just great. And the phrasing, everybody's listening so closely. And it's just, I love playing that for students.
Yeah.
These old. Yeah.
I mean, that chart is a masterclass in not only writing, but obviously a testament to the musicians on the. Bandstand. What a tour de force that was.
Yeah,
thank
really
you for bringing for bringing that to us today.
No, yeah, it's a good, that's a great one.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm glad you like it. And you know, we're jumping right out of the chute pretty hardcore here.
Yeah. Don Ellis. Yeah, right.
With that in mind, let me maybe we should switch over to Pretty Ballad. Why don't we could play Dick Nash playing? Dick Nash is such a huge influence too as a
yes.
And talk about sound. This is the first trombone player I really heard. And it was this track that I sent you. It was really the first trombone solo I heard. But actually, before I even heard Tommy Dorsey or any of the other players, the Dick Nash, and being such an amazing musician on so many levels in so many different ways, but his voice as a trombonist is so incredible and probably one of the most heard.
Yeah.
You know, for me growing up, especially, I mean, you hear him all that. You go to the grocery store, you're going to hear him. You hear him on TV shows and movies, and it's always, you can pick it out. It's like when Gerald sing. Whenever I'm in a restaurant and they're playing like the Pandora, you know, jazz thing in a restaurant or something, you hear all these singers, and all of a sudden you hear Ella. It's just like bright light. You don't, before you even hear that it's her, you know it's her because you can hear it.
Yeah.
It's that distinct thing. And Dick Nash and Irby Green are the two trombonists that I find have that kind of magical. I'm the RCA Victor dog, you know, just completely. Anyway, why don't we just play that? Cause that's the Mancini band, which is time, of course, made up of some of the greatest jazz players. You know, he'd have sometimes Shelly Mann playing drums or and the Condoli brothers and Plas Johnson playing saxophone and all these wonderful jazz musicians that were in the band. And also a young Johnny Williams playing the piano on some of these records.
Yeah.
Might actually be on this record.
Which record is this? Is it? It's not Mancini 67.
That's different. I forget when this one actually came out first, because I have it in a compilation.
You know,
Is this My One Only Love?
Yes.
Yeah. I forget which record this one's
on. I don't know.
Helen, if you're listening, chime in. You can add it.
And Josh is the ultimate Henry Mancini geek, so he might find out.
Not ultimate, but I don't know what record that is off the top of my head. I'll look it up.
The Google machine.
The Google machine.
It's kind of funny that I think that the Mancini records that I own always have a ballad on it that showcase Dick.
Yeah.
On Mancini 67, I believe it's, or no, is it Mancini Shadow of Your Smile? Yeah. Yeah. And then on, what is that? Uniquely Mancini. It's a dip. Right. Right. Exactly.
I forget which record this was from. Yeah. Anyway, but this is, and actually Tom Kubis wrote an arrangement for me of this tune.
Yeah. We played that. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, a few months ago with the band,
Well, yes, of course. I brought in, and you said bring in a chart, and I brought in a feature.
Yeah, which you totally should do. If you get that chance, then take it, you know?
Again, as a trombonist, that's what we do. If we were going to bring in a chart, we're probably going to bring in a trombone feature.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Well, Dick and Melinda actually showed up last week at the big band showcase that I did at the Mint.
Oh, great!
All of a sudden, I'm sitting at the bar with Shep and Sal came out too, and all of a sudden we see them over there. It's, oh shit, it's Dick Nash.
He comes out. Those two, you can find him almost every game.
Amazing.
Yeah. His life now is going to concerts. He's like, he's picked up Chuck Niles' gig. You know, that's where Chuck was at every gig. And Dick and Melinda, that's so great to see them there. And Dick's still he's the same person he's always been, just wonderfully warm and encouraging.
Beautiful cat.
And this week is also his birthday. I'm blanking on the date, but this week is his 94th birthday.
94.
Mm-hmm. You should probably have it back. Maybe a birthday.
Yeah.
Or something. Yeah. I think this is. Yeah. I think I found it. Is this from Henry Mancini? The Mancini Touch, 1960.
That's what it is. Mancini.
Nice.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Very cool. Okay. Looking forward to checking out some Dick Nash.
Yeah. Let's listen to Dick Nash on "My One and Only Love" with Henry Mancini. Here we go.
Gorgeous.
I mean, it's so amazing how that ending just always gets me, and it just the way he holds out note and just goes down to the major seventh, and it's just so perfect. And again, that's what I was talking about with Charlie. He just does enough embellishment. It's not over the top. It's just perfect. It's It's so great. And that word embellishment, I think, is something that I really try to emphasize when I'm working with students, or especially new to improvising, is that the way of making a melody your own unique kind of thing, before you worry about chord changes and scales and all that stuff, when you take a melody and do something like that, you know, that's as legitimate a form of improvisation and as personal and as soulful as a, you know, the perfect, you know, Lydian dominant, you know, kind of scale pattern that you could come up with.
Absolutely.
It's in many ways, I don't want to go so far as to say it's a lost art, but I think it's an overlooked art. Nick Nash is to me a master of that. When he plays a melody, he just has a way of putting a spin on something. And, you know, he actually credits another great jazz musician that's overlooked a lot in the jazz history books in terms of trombone, is a great trombonist named Murray McEachern. Sort of one of Dick's predecessors, who played with Benny Goodman and toured, and he was a fantastic musician, a great alto sax player and violinist as well. And he played the trombone and had this loose kind of way of approaching melodies. He recorded a couple albums that are great, that are reworking. It would say the name of the standard, but he would play a totally different melody, but it was always recognizable. You always knew what tune he was playing. It's sort of like Coleman Hawkins with Body and Soul, you know, where you know it's Body and Soul. Everybody knew it was Body and Soul, but he was not playing Body and Soul. He was making and using the tune as a departure, as a way of saying something. And then that's something that really always impressed me so much, and still does, about Dick Nash's playing, is his way of just putting enough spin on things to make it personal. And you feel like you know the guy from hearing him play. That's him. That is largely his, as a person, he's every bit as sincere and genuine as his trombone playing. And which is I mean, very, very, very few of your heroes are necessarily going to be the same kind of person as they are as a player. But Dick is one of those rare individuals who's every bit as great a human as he is as a player. He kind of made me irritated when I actually got to know him, because I said, God, you're supposed to be you're not supposed to be so nice.
Yeah, stop that.
Yeah.
He's a classic mensch in my mind, man.
Yeah. His son is just a classic mensch to me, who I've had the pleasure of working with a number of times.
His other kids, too. They're, they used to have Juan Racy used to have dinners in honor of certain players, and then one with Dick was especially great. It borders on a roast at times, but Sip's another one. Gene Cipriano, of course, is another one. It's that same way. He's just this wonderful person as well as a great musician, and he spoke at it, which was very funny. But his kids also spoke, and a couple of them I had not met. His daughter Nikki.
I haven't met Nikki.
Nikki's I think she works in the film industry.
Okay.
And his other son, who's non-musician, it was hilarious, and it was just great hearing all of them talk about their dad, and it was very moving. And boy, it's no surprise that all his kids came out really cool and interesting. I only met Barbara, who passed away many years ago, and she was they were an incredible pairing at the time. You know, they were a really wonderful couple, and so many of those musicians, I think he was kind of such a great example for the attitude among the musicians at work. You know, he was very he was a real brought people together well.
Yeah,
he's always been that way. Very supportive and great, 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 great guy. And so fun to see him showing up to gigs and stuff. It's an extension of his personality. Anyway, but Dick is to this day. I'm so lucky. I feel so good that I was actually able to tell him this. I said, there isn't a day that goes by when I open that trombone case and I don't think of you.
Aww,
that's true. That's beautiful.
That's the sound and the. It's like, okay, how much closer to that can I get? Still a long way to go.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just anyway. So,
wow.
What else are we gonna? We could talk a little bit about other things in LA. One thing, I'm sort of going back to, like, the Gary Foster was a big influence on me, and he taught at the Pasadena City College. He conducted a jazz band there, which was a blast, because there's this amazing musician with all this experience and knowledge of the music, and he was teaching jazz band, and great educator. Gary's always been a great teacher, and Sal Lozano and I would. That was our first regular jazz band. We played in a band with Gary, an alt Southern jazz band. We played with him. We both got into it. And then he invited us to come play at the Pasadena City College Band when they needed somebody to come play. And so that was our first experience playing, both Sal and me, playing with older players who were, you know, because it was a college band, but it was like a community band, a really good community band. And Gary would bring in, had a lot of charts by Claire Fisher in that book. And every day at rehearsal, before the rehearsal, we had hand-copied either Lenny Tristano or Warren Marsh contrafacts on tunes, and we would just pass those out and we'd sight read them. And it was so
I know where this is going.
Yeah. and it was such a great experience. The other person that was at PCC a little bit after that was Bobby Bradford. I don't know if you're familiar with Bobby. And yeah. Bobby was really such a big influence on West Coast jazz in so many ways, as far as like more the free jazz movement out here in LA, which was really, I mean, there was a whole other side of music there. We mentioned earlier, you know, Eric Dolphy was here, and there was a great scene that was very influential that, again, people don't associate with the traditional kind of more straight ahead kind of, you know, more accessible
right
house all-stars kind of jazz, which, you know, again was great. And Bobby Radford was great at getting people, you know, to improvise and compose in different ways and opening people up to all different kinds of musical things. A lot of people who went to PCC at that time continued on in that world. And it was great. I mean, it was such a vital, interesting world that he occupied. And I really loved all that kind of musical stuff that was going on, just a little community college out in Pasadena.
Yeah.
That was great. And, yeah, another thing, people, I was just thinking about this, you know, those 10 years that Mingus was here in the 50s, that was a big thing too. And I think it people don't associate him as much with the West Coast, but he was
not at all
huge. I mean, that was a huge little period that when he was here, and there were so many other musicians that were a part of that and sort of built around him. He had a band here. I can't remember all the people that were in his band here,
but he's from California.
He was actually from Arizona, I believe.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You're right. Yeah.
Arizona, but he I think from like early 50s to the early 60s, he was out here.
Yeah.
And that was right in the heyday of what people consider the West Coast thing. You know, we're players moving here from the Kenton Band and
right.
Other things. And but you know, there was a whole other thing that it doesn't sound like the things that we label the West Coast jazz.
Not at all.
One other thing about the West Coast is it's not just LA. I mean, the musical influences all up and down the West Coast of the United States. I mean, there was a nice scene in San Francisco. You know, you have Dave Brubeck from up there, and of course Johnny Guarnieri, right? The Peanuts guy. he was a great jazz piano player and very well known as a player. And then, you know, you go into the period of the 80s and 90s, the Northwest had a pretty nice scene up in like Seattle area. There were a lot of great musicians that were sort of settling up there for a while. Names escape me at this point, but I remember there were like half dozen really nice little jazz clubs up in Seattle. And so I think that that moniker, I the more you think about it, it starts to become a little less. Or maybe it's more than what people assume it to be. And in other ways, it's less than what people assume it to be. And then there are people who are associated with West Coast jazz that never lived here. I mean, I think somebody like Stan Getz, a lot of times people sort of categorize as a West Coast player. And then you have some players in New York that have as much of a West Coast kind of sound to their playing as some of the players that have that same label out here. It's kind of interesting.
Oh, absolutely.
And I'm being the kind of musician that I like to be, where I'm kind of eclectic in my taste, and it almost bothers
no kidding.
Me. Yeah, yeah, well, it kind of bothers me when people make a label to have a place to put it in a record store. That's the way it used to be. And you have the jazz albums, and then across the street, you have the classical albums and stuff like that. And I found that those barriers close people's minds off sometimes to things that they might really like. You know,
totally.
Oh, I'm not into blues. The blues thing. What? Are you crazy?
Yeah.
You know, there's lots of stuff that you could check out that you would probably like, you know. So it's I don't know, it's just a personal pet peeve. I'm not going to use this as a soapbox.
Well, I mean, Art Pepper describes that in his book that he wrote with Laurie about Central Ave, that when he got to the scene, he was a 15-year-old kid, 16-year-old, and he was playing all of this jazz that he taught himself. And then he started to play. One of the first bands that he was starting to play was with Lee Young, Lester Young's brother, and Charles Mingus, for
right.
example.
Right.
Or the example of Cannonball moving out to the West Coast also.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Playing a bunch out here, live at the Lighthouse, live in Seattle, but doing a bunch of TV stuff. And Oliver Nelson moving out also to the West Coast.
DJ Johnson moved out here.
Right, right.
And then even Quincy Jones. I mean, that was and then you get people like Herbie Hancock and Wayne Shorter live here now.
Yeah.
Maria lived here. I mean, it's very interesting. And then there was a period of time Bob Brookmeyer was out here for a little bit.
That's true. Yeah.
So it's very interesting. And he's to me, in a lot of ways, especially his earlier stuff is very, Bob Brookmeyer's music is very West Coasty.
Yes, absolutely.
Mulligan. But they were always primarily New York players. That was actually sort of the player I was thinking of. To me, a lot of that, Charlie Hayden, another influential person, who was kind of my boss for a while up at Cal Arts when I was teaching up there. And so that was really interesting getting to talk to him a little bit about stuff. You know, his background was fascinating because he was part of a family country band. There was a Missouri or Kansas or somewhere wherever he was from originally, and that's what he was doing for a long time. And then, boom, took a left turn, left the family in the dust.
His own thing. So I didn't know that.
It's very interesting where people's and also the roots of where they started, where they end up, where they go, you know, for a period of time. It's a pretty universal thing. And now with the music coming out of all different parts of the world, it's fascinating that and the different spins, you know, like the Europe jazz from Europe, as you well know, Kevin. I mean, it has a different take on it in a lot of ways than any
yeah.
in the United States. And then you go to some places where the music's going on in parts of East and West Africa. I mean, that the music being created there is fascinating, especially
yeah.
some instrumental sort of jazz oriented stuff. It's ridiculous. It's really interesting and different. And you know, anywhere in the world, you can find this musical energy that I think is in keeping with all the stuff that's happened before. And Charlie Parker was even out here for a while.
That's true. Yeah. That's true. He came out here with this because he wasn't able to work in New York because he didn't have that cabaret card. Yeah.
It's wild.
Yeah. Stan Levy came out with Dizzy on that band with Bird and Ray Brown.
Yeah. By the way, I meant to ask you, I can't remember who played guitar on the Mancini thing. Was it Billy?
Usually Mancini would use, I guess, maybe Howard Roberts.
I was thinking it was Howard Roberts.
I've always heard that intro. I was listening to it especially carefully. That intro he plays on that tune.
Yeah.
It's so perfect. And it's just the way he pushes the time a little bit.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. It's just so delicate and perfect.
Yeah.
It's that mentality of those people recording records, you know, three or four records a day. In the studio doing all that stuff, and just this, the stuff was just flowing out of them.
That's the stuff that's identical. That identifies the West Coast, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Being so specific. And there's something I'm thinking about what we talked also about with Peter Erskine, because he showed some example from Shelly Mann, where Shelly had just a few bars to fill in. And he was so musical and so specific. And then Peter said, yeah, that's something that identifies the West Coast musicians, because they're able to make something out of a short amount of time, but it's perfect.
Very true. And we think of those like great classic Sinatra records with somebody like Harry Sweets Edison, who was here. I heard
about
New Rock High School. You know, I heard it, and he would take a four bar solo and play three notes, and it was magic. And same thing with Pete Chrislieb, who was here for so long. I've heard him many times. I was in, I remember several times sitting at Capitol Records doing a big band date for a singer, and Pete has an eight bar solo, and we recorded it 10, 15 times.
Mm.
And he would do something different every single time, and it was always great. And it was something you could hum. It's just so melodic and perfect. And I remember a few times, and Warren Looney, another person, he was that way. Just economy. I guess maybe it's just an economical way of playing, very efficient way of playing. Again, largely out of the fact that so many of these things were recorded in massive numbers of recordings and songs that were coming out of the studios here. It definitely affects your choices as an improviser. It's sort of, I'm thinking off the top of my head again, which is very dangerous, but I think that there's in some of these crossover kind of recording situations that we're mentioning, like Mancini or Sinatra or any of those things where there'd be it had a commercial element. It's very interesting how people within that little box where you think, okay, it's got to be a little less, you know, you can't completely play as freely as you might if you were in a club just playing, you know, your own jazz record, whatever. There's a way of compartmentalizing yourself to be, how do you make a lot out of very little? It's like Baroque art, you know, you have a small canvas maybe that you have to do a very interesting little piece of art. And I think that people like all the people we mentioned, Blas Johnson was another one, Harry Sweets Edison, Warren, Pete Chrisley, Tom Rainier. These are players that are really good at making a beautiful little statement in a short amount of time. And it's a challenge. It's a different thing than taking six choruses on Giant Steps. I mean, you're going to have to do something very different, you know, in your fourth and fifth chorus. You're going to have to really be going somewhere interesting. And when you have only those eight bars, it kind of is important to not necessarily make it about you, but make it about the music and supplementing it, that song with something interesting that complements whatever you're doing musically. And that's some people really get that. You know, Dick Nash being one. And
well, speak of the devil, he's here. He's watching.
Oh, he's watching?
Hi, Dick. Yeah.
Dick. Hey. He's everybody's favorite.
Yeah.
We just played your feature on My One and Only Love, Dick.
Yeah. Still got it, Mancini.
Yeah, still got it.
Every trombone player upset every time that song
I mean, speaking about that, the what you just brought up, Alex, about the, you know, saying a lot in a short amount of time, I mean, to me, some of the focus of what we've been trying to look at, and the original idea of this show that we had was music that had been recorded in specific studios by, you know, specific labels such as Contemporary, based in Los Angeles, you know, Liberty Records, World Pacific, you know, and like this Bill Perkins record on stage that I just love. Also somebody I got to play with in Mike Burone's Big Band, who's a monster. I was just marveling at Holman's and Mandel's arrangements and how they would just, these little solo moments, and you'd have to say what you need to say in eight bars, you know. So that style of arranging, and in some ways the West Coast moniker is leaving something out, of course, like you said, from maybe other cities along the West Coast. But if I had to pick another name for the show, it would maybe be like, you know, LA roots or LA's connections, you know, and the names that have come up probably the most on this show are Jack Sheldon and Dick Nash and Disney. Actually, Disney has been a unifying line as well. But it's an interesting topic that I like to discuss. And it's, you hear the, I was in Japan and the guy said, I was in a record shop. And he goes, oh, you're a musician? And I'm like, yeah. And he goes, where are you from? Los Angeles. Oh, West Coast jazz. Like, he was quick to like, yeah, put the label on too. And I was kind of like, okay, cool, I guess. But you're right, there's so much more to it. Yeah,
there is. But you know, there's also the idea, any publicity is good publicity, you know. That's I think that applies. But you know, you mentioned somebody like Jack Sheldon, I mean, who was to me the desert island person, you know. If you had one person to bring with you to be stuck on a desert island to entertain you, one. He could tell you jokes, he could sing you songs, he could play you some great jazz, and he has always been, you know. And that was another connection with jazz, of course, is the comedy jazz connection, which
absolutely
has always been, you know, going back to Lenny Bruce and the beatnik comics that were doing stuff in jazz clubs. There's always been this relationship between jazz musicians and comedians, and some of them crossing over into each other's world. And Jack was, again, first time I heard him was at those Eagle Rock High School concerts, and he would hold court and say things that would be like, whoa, this is a high school.
Yeah. I love the student body.
Exactly. But he was he was and as a player, I still hear him today, and it's just it is such an evocative West Coast thing. I mean, you can't and Shorty Rogers, of course,
Oh, yeah.
people like that. So it's really interesting. And you mentioned Art Pepper, and I mean, there were some other players I can think of too that I associate with Jack because of those Eagle Rock concerts. There was Frank Morgan, great alto player, who was a good friend of
Absolutely.
Art Pepper. Actually, they were in prison together, I believe.
Yeah, I can't believe
Yeah,
that.
they had their horns in prison. They said they used to hang out, and I think it was in Straight
Oh
Life.
yeah.
Talks about they just sit in the corner and play ballads.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
It's like a movie scene, man. I would love to see that. But yeah, it is interesting, and that's yeah, it follows you like that. I like you mentioned, Josh, that if you say you're a jazz musician from Los Angeles, it is going to be something people assume about you. And
Right.
again, I personally don't have a problem with it because it's such a big part of my growing up and my experience with music and
Right.
culture.
Absolutely. And proud hometown, roots. I'm from
Yeah,
here. I'm from Long
totally.
Beach,
Yeah,
and you're
I
from, you
appreciate
said Arcadia?
Yeah, Arcadia.
Oh,
Not
that's
a jazz
great.
mecca.
Well,
Yeah.
I mean, you guys are living examples of however you want to call it, but I'm going to call it like true West Coast jazz musicians, and you guys do it all. Josh writes his own music and is very inspired by the film, and for me also very identifiable music. If I hear something of Josh, I go, "Yep, that's Josh right there." Or when you're playing Alex, and it's like, "Oh yeah, that's Alex right there," and it's so identifiable for somebody who's not from here.
Yeah.
But yeah, it speaks for you.
Yeah,
Yeah.
that's good. That's good. Yeah, it is sort of an enigmatic topic. And there's like anything interesting, there's aspects of it that are probably positive and others that are maybe a little bit, you wonder. It makes you ask questions, and that's good. Asking questions is good. And it's
Yeah.
still a topic of conversation. I think that the future of whatever is the West Coast thing is, like I mentioned it earlier, I think it's fantastic. I mean, I'm just thinking about the players I know locally that I've been hearing either in your band or in other bands. The big band scene alone is in great shape, actually, I think, in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
So many of the great young composers and arrangers that are coming out of the schools and also moving here and who are maybe involved in film and all this sort of stuff. It's really great. And there are still some people who are veterans who are still creative, like Willis. Bill Holman is just
Oh,
still
yeah.
ridiculous. And so I think it's a really nice time. And then the club scene has always been in flux, which is part of the LA scene forever. Every great club eventually is replaced by another one in 10 years. And but there's still, there's new places cropping up with people getting to play and do the thing. And of course, everybody wishes there was a little bit more of a financial stake to support it. There was a time when a good jazz musician in LA would maybe have a supplement of a little bit of studio work on the side, but they basically made a good living, bought homes, sent kids to college, and were able to have an okay life in Los Angeles as a jazz musician. And that's sad that there's fewer and fewer opportunities for that. Although there's still people, that maybe have to tour more or teach more. And that's a story for all musicians. We all have to kind of branch out, and there are different ways of communicating than there were. And we have to adapt. And being, I think, as a group, jazz musicians are pretty adaptable and always have been. And I think that's good, that they will be able to survive in a world no matter what it is, whatever the restrictions are. I think jazz musicians are pretty creative at finding ways of sharing their music and being able to be heard. It might not make them rich, but if they were wanting to be rich, why are they pursuing jazz in the first place? Obviously not. But
Absolutely.
so that's I'm optimistic.
Likewise.
That I see the people around making the music they're making, and that to me is that's the ticket. If that's happening, then we're in good shape.
Exactly.
Well
Yeah.
said.
I agree. Yeah.
Great.
Maybe we should go to some music. You mentioned Bob Florence, and I would like to go into something that you're actually on.
Yeah, I'd like that too.
That I this is a live concert. We played a couple nights at the Moonlight Tango, which is a club that's gone now, of course. That was on the Boulevard, and they had a big band night on Mondays. And Bob decided to record an album there, and it was Fly by the Seat of Your Pants. And I remember on this particular track, on Fun Upsmanship, we recorded it. I think we did three nights there, and the first two nights we usually open with this tune. I think it was usually the opener, and my solo the first couple nights, I wasn't very happy with, and I was so mad that the third night I felt it finally got it out. It was one of those things. God, why didn't I just get the first one and then have fun the next two nights? Kind of sweating bullets. I knew Bob wasn't really pleased with the track yet. And I'm like, oh, okay. So the way it came out. So it's okay. And the band is great. Steve Allen's playing drums on this one. Ooh. And Tom Warrington. It's great. It was a wonderful week there. And we had fun. One of the other highlights was that the Moonlight Tango, they did a Baked Alaska thing where they set fire to a dessert.
Mm-hmm.
And flambeau. And they did it right in the middle of Warren Looney, one of his trumpet solos. So here we are recording. He's playing this real intimate little harmon mute trumpet solo in this big flame and this heat wave covering him. It's one of those things. It's just like maybe you had to be there, but it was so hilarious. Like, oh, yeah, we're in a club. Yeah, okay. Anyway. Oh, that's fun upsmanship. This is a tour de force big band, another loud big band arrangement.
Hey, I'm loving it so far with the loud big band stuff. Yeah. Here we go. We're going to take a listen to Bob Florence Big Band with Alex Iles included. He's going to have a trombone solo on his track.
Trying to keep up with the tempo.
Yep. Fun upsmanship. Here we go. That's also a tongue twister for you right there.
Oh, yeah.
Here we go.
Yeah, non-Spanish, non-
We'll be right back.
Bob Effort.
Hogan.
That's a fun drum part to play.
Steve yeah, Houghton how plays he... the shit out of that arrangement.
Yeah, he does.
Oof. He really does, man. He was really fun in that band. He had a real I liked his energy on that tune like that, especially. It was really, really great. We had several really good drummers on Bob's band at different times, and its last incantation version it was Peter was playing
yeah,
and it was really, that was probably for Bob among the most satisfying concerts we played, was when Peter was playing drums. He always, I'll be honest, I mean he really missed having Nick Cirilli. Nick had a very special connection with Bob's music. I mean that's the first really great drummer that Bob had access to as a regular part of the band, and it was really difficult when you have such an imprint of somebody like Nick Cirilli. I mean, it wasn't just like a great drummer, it was Nick Cirilli. He really had that sound and feel in his head, and it was very difficult for anybody playing drums in that band.
Yeah,
it was always a matter of being compared to him, and it was not Bob's fault or anybody's fault necessarily, but it was always difficult, and we went through some good drummers in that band. There were some great drummers that came and went, and you know, I think Peter was the closest I think Bob ever felt to having the spirit of that thing that Nick brought to the table, that was, I knew about from listening to it. I never played in the band with Nick, but I always
no, there's some YouTube footage of the memorial concert where Bob just passed, of you guys at Catalina's, where you're in the band and Charlie's in the band and Peter's playing, mm-hmm. and
Goodwin and all the other guys, yeah.
And Peter showed us this. It's a ridiculous recording of the new Phonic Orchestra. Stan Kenton leading the new Phonic Orchestra, and it was supposed to be Shelley on that recording, but it turned out to be Nick. And Nick, it's kind of a feature piece for Nick that's written by John Williams. Wow. And we started from that spot because it's a 10 minute piece or something like that. And start on that spot, the drum solo, and I'm listening and I go, is this Peter or is this Nick Cirilli? But Peter mentions that Nick Cirilli has been a huge influence on his playing, and it's so
yeah,
clear.
You hear it. Yeah, it's interesting. Yeah, I remember hearing the band at places like Carmelo's and a couple
of with times. Cirilli.
With Cirilli, yeah.
Yeah.
I was so in love with that band. I mean, it was sort of like his band and Toshiko's band were kind of going at the same time, and it was what a and Willis's band too. I mean, and Gerald Willis's band had a great. I mean, those bands were so good, and it was so inspiring to see all these great players like that. And it's interesting. It's interesting how in a lot of the situations in LA, big bands have always been such a huge part of the scene here. You know, you have a lot of the, I think maybe Josh, what do you think about this? I'm going to make again off the top of my head, very dangerous. Mm-hmm. I would posit that a lot of the West Coast sound, I think can be attributed a lot to the arrangers, especially for large ensemble. You know, you get somebody like Marty Paich, who was writing for
that
sort of nonet style too, that arranged mini big band too. That's a huge part of the,
absolutely,
you know, Dave Pell, you know, all that
Dave kind Pell of and Pete Rugolo. Oh yeah.
Yeah. And Marty. And there were so many great composers and arrangers that were settling here. I mean, probably doing TV, you know, Terry Gibbs's dream band, you know, Terry Gibbs, that band was a Steve Allen show, basically.
Speak of the devil, Terry's here and he's asking you, why didn't you play in the dream band?
I would have, you just have to ask. those dream band records, that reissue, on Mosaic, right? With the all the dream band stuff. Have you heard that? Salazano turned me on to that. And it's live. It's almost all live concerts.
Yeah.
Terry out there cheerleading on every tune. Yeah. Oh man, to be a fly on the wall in that in those concerts.
Oh yeah.
And with the I'm just still that band in a lot of ways became kind of the between that and also a band that people don't talk about, and it was a huge influence with the Tonight Show band.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, you had Snooky Young back there. I mean, the father of modern big band jazz playing. Lead playing. I mean, he was a huge influence. I mean, he's as important as just about any soloist in as a jazz improviser. Snooky set the pace, man, for playing lead trumpet in a big band. And he was the lead with the Tonight Show. And it was such a great, we had Chris Lieb and Ross Thomas and all these, Ed Shaughnessy playing drums, ex New Yorker came out for the show. And also we lost a great trombone player from that Tonight Show band, Gil Falco.
Yeah,
he was a fantastic jazz trombone player and lead trombone player. I never got to play with him. I mean, you know, he was doing the Tonight Show the whole time I was kind of getting started. And what a beautiful player. I knew a lot of the players who were his contemporaries and always spoke so highly of him. And I have recordings of him playing with there were a couple big trombone records that had large ensembles, and Gil plays solos and it just sounds killer. He's a wonderful, wonderful player, and very underrated player. I think historically it was really.
Have you also seen some of that footage of Terry's all-star band on the Steve Allen show?
Oh my god.
Oh yeah. Great.
And what a crazy group of people, man. Those are some fun people. You know, you get somebody like
Fontana,
yeah,
and Jerome Richardson,
and then you get people like Med Flory in there too.
Yep.
Another person who bridged the gap between, you know, he was an actor and a saxophonist,
right?
Yeah, it's very interesting, very interesting. And yeah, and all those great players. It's great. And then also another person I was thinking about is also in terms of the Mancini thing is Larry Bunker.
Yeah.
One of the top call percussionists in the studios. I knew him mostly from doing movies and stuff, and he was a timpanist. He was always the timpanist with a very low voice, and he would ask questions that was very distinctive. it was always beautiful to hear him ask a question. It was sort of an event. But he was a great jazz drummer and
Oh, yeah.
violin, great improviser. And
We had a we did a fun tribute show to him last
oh,
year.
perfect.
Yeah. And
Yeah.
that was with Jeff Hamilton and Chuck Berghofer
And
and Mike
Chuck.
Lang, right?
Mike Lang,
That
yep.
was a fun hang. Larry
Oh,
Bunker
that's
stories. Yeah, Larry
great.
was just brilliant, able to traverse, studio work and film
And
work and jazz playing.
he was so literate too. He read everything. He knew about music. He would ask me questions once in a while, and I didn't know him that well, but he would come up and say, "I was listening to the Mozart Requiem. There's a big trombone solo in that piece. I really enjoy." It was like we were just starting to talk about stuff. He had a huge breadth of interests in and out of music.
Yeah.
Really interesting guy.
Right.
Loved him. Yeah, and I guess Shelley was kind of that way too. I love that record with Shelley and that I think you and I talked about this record, Kevin. Shelley plays like found objects.
Yeah,
Him and
Jack Marshall, yeah.
Jack Marshall, and it's called Sounds. Do you have that record?
Yeah,
Oh,
yeah.
my dad had that record. That's another weird record in my dad's record collection. I used to listen to that all the time. I love that whole idea of just he's playing a suitcase and he's playing all this stuff with brushes, and it's a great idea.
I don't know that.
Yeah,
Isn't that funny?
well, I mean, it's not a surprise that you're such an eclectic, musician because of all of the records
He had
that you're
some wild
naming.
records. Yeah, he had some wild.
Yeah.
Spike Jones was a big influence
Oh,
too.
Spike Jones.
Yeah, I mean that's where I sort of I went to a place musically kind of like that. Again, kind of combined with my Disney experience. I had a group in college. We wanted to start a jazz combo, but we didn't really have access to a lot of good rhythm section players at the time. And I wanted to start a trombone quartet, but we didn't really have a good bass trombonist. Usually you have a bass trombone in a quartet. So this sax player friend and I, we wanted to start this group. I said, "Hey, why don't we start a quartet with three trombones and a sax?" So we started this group, and it was basically influenced by Spike Jones and Petey Kubak, but we also did a lot of jazz stuff. The sax player Frank Silva, who's now a clarinetist with the Kalamazoo Symphony, I believe. He ended up arranging some Horace Silver tunes for this group, and we did those, and we had no rhythms. It was all a sort of an a cappella group, and it was so fun. And we had an entire book of Halloween music. We thought if nobody else has a Halloween book, so we could be the one band that could work Halloween gigs. group. So, but we did parodies of classical pieces like Spike Jones. And if you want to check out my website, a few of those are on my website in the sounds that we do a version of the Nutcracker Suite and William Tell.
Oh, fun.
Yeah, and it's kind of fun, and they're crazy arrangements. We basically take a lot of the two of the guys wrote the arrangements, and we would take their straight arrangements and then tweak them and make them funny or silly or destroy them. But it was a great group because it was a very creative ensemble. We did a lot of it was all comedy. It was a silly little thing. We had choreography and the whole thing, and it was a fun little group, and we. I learned a lot that ended up helping me professionally again by serendipity, really. Because once I started working in the studios, one of the first things I started doing regularly in the studios was cartoon music. And all the little techniques that we used in Electric Mustard, that came back into play when I started playing the cartoons. And I had a great mentorship under Alan Kaplan, who's the master of the comedy, comic cartoon trombone style. He's
Yeah.
really great at it with all the plunger mute and Harmon mute and funny wild sounds. He's really good at that stuff. So I between my Electric Mustard experience and sort of listening to Alan, it was really a fun period there when I was learning all this crazy stuff. And I as a jazz musician, it creeps in once in a while, and I'll do something a little. I don't like to necessarily just play it straight on tunes, and so it's kind of fun once in a while to have that outlet. And when and Sal and I now have a group called All In, which
That's
is
right.
all original music, and we all write a little bit for it. And that's been fun to experiment, have a group to experiment with Trey Henry and Ray Brinker and Dave Witham and Andrew Sinewick and
Do you want to show something off of that, of All
Okay.
In?
I have a tune. Oh, boy, I'd have to dig it up. I'm sorry. It would probably take me a second.
Let me dig it up because I'm on.
If you want, there's on our recording we did. There's one of my tunes is on there, called "Coming Back
Yeah,
Home."
let's hear it if they
It's
find
a
it.
kind of
Yeah.
gospel. It was a It was influenced by Jaco Pastorius and Saturday Night Live. It's sort of like credits to Saturday Night Live.
Awesome.
It
sounds great.
From Everything's Gonna Be Great?
No, that's Sal's record.
That's
All In.
Okay.
And Coming Back Home.
All In, Coming.
I need a millennial to help me.
here we go. Yeah.
Food for thought while Kevin's pulling this up, Alex. Since you've done so much film work over the years, I'm a film music lover, film lover, and soundtrack lover.
Oh, good.
You could think of maybe one or two or three of your favorite scores you played on, if you can. I'm just curious, after we listen to this, maybe we can just talk about that a little bit, or your favorite composers.
Sure. Well, I mean, I've been it's been a long time sort of developing into that. But, you know, like their scores, especially jazz-oriented scores like The Incredibles, that was
really, yeah.
I played on most of Michael Giacchino's movies that he's recorded in.
Yeah.
That's always fun because it is like a jazz thing because he's so spontaneous and loves changing things. And it's a very creative environment. And we have a lot of fun as an orchestra. It's like a band. You know, a lot of us have been.
Those are great scores. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's great at what he does. And now he's getting into directing and all kinds of stuff. He's kind of a Renaissance guy.
Yeah.
Kind of. He really is. I've gotten to, you know, I've recorded quite a bit with John Williams the last few years doing the last three Star Wars movies, which is a total treat. The first time I worked for him, I was actually filling in kind of last minute. I think they added a trombone. And so I was playing second trombone the first time and they'd already recorded, a bit of the score in the days before I was there. So they were going back to a cue from the day before. So I'm basically sight reading this, you know, John Williams sometimes records 3 or 4 minute long cues all in one take. He doesn't do much punching. So
no pressure.
Wow. Yeah, it's like a concert right away. So I sit down 10 in the morning and it was for a movie called The War Horse, which was an interesting movie about World War I. And that movie it's literally a flute concerto for Luis de Tullio. And it's a beautiful score, actually, if you love scores.
I love that. I've heard it. It's gorgeous.
Yeah, good. Some of the most beautiful English pastoral kind of influenced music. It's beautiful. He nailed it. Anyway, so I come in and I'm sight reading this piece and it's a little involved and he never underwrites for trombone. I mean, you always have lots to do and lots of things to screw up. So I'm just trying to hang on. You know, everybody else knows this piece and I'm just sort of filling in and I get through it. And Bill Booth was playing principal trombone, always played principal for John Williams for years and years. Mm-hmm. He was giving me a few pointers on what to look out for and, you know, and John doesn't use click very much. He does most of it to timing it. He just does it himself with the timing of the picture.
Incredible.
So you really are you're in a little bit of an awkward situation if you're used to playing with a click and all that kind of stuff. But anyway, so I'm just hanging on for dear life, and I get through it. And I noticed behind me there was somebody filming, and that's very common now in studios. They do a lot of archival shooting, so you get kind of used to with the camera people doing their thing, and they're usually really good about, you know, being quiet. And so I sort of was aware of somebody shooting and I'm great. And I'm like, first time and I'm going to be on the archive footage and I hope I don't screw up, you know, just hanging on in survival mode. And I turn around and it's Steven Spielberg with a little camera, a little video camera. And he's shooting, he's right over my shoulder. And I was so like, it hit me so hard. I looked at him. I said, you know, today's my first day here. And he looked at me and said, oh, you did pretty good.
Oh wow!
It was so funny because he's a musician too. You know, he's actually played clarinet on a couple of John's
right
stuff to play. Anyway, he's great. He films.
Wow.
I don't know what he does with all that footage. You know, he films almost all the sessions. I imagine he has some big dinner party with his friends and he throws up a, you know, puts up on the VCR and, you know, in his home entertainment thing. Oh, look at watch John's score from this movie. Like home movies or something. And I can imagine his family going, oh, Dad, you have to.
That's a great story. Oh my gosh. How cool is that? I think we're going to do in a couple weeks, it's John's 90th birthday.
Oh. Yeah.
So we're going to do a tribute show for him.
Great.
Play some of the old stuff, probably some film scores, but his Johnny Williams days, of course.
And those big band records he did, of course, too. Lady. Yeah, he's amazing. He's
amazing.
Monster. Yeah, and so humble about it. And he just has this way of getting the most out of whatever group he's conducting. He's really good. He's almost like a teacher when he's up there. You know, he has great analogies. Like he has the one time he had the violins up on a high harmonic. He's all, I want that to sound like a question mark. And you hear it, and when you watch the movie, you can tell the character's feeling. It's exactly what's going on. It's such a great connection to character, and of what's, you know, he writes themes for characters, of course, but he also just he gets inside their motivations in such a
master.
Deep cerebral level. I mean, he knows.
I mean, I could talk to you about this all day, Alex. I didn't mean to sidetrack your all in. I got excited, man.
Yeah, I know. It's great. I mean, I love talking about it. I'm still a newbie in
right
with him, but
have you checked out that score he did for the 60s film Diamond Head with George Chakiris and Charlton Heston?
Oh, ridiculous.
I love it because it's his jazz side and the film score soundtrack side, and it's kind of coming together in this cool.
Exactly. That's like some of those Mancini TV shows.
Totally. It's right cut from the same cloth.
Yeah. And same thing with, there have been several of the other composers that have some jazz background. That's always, I've worked a fair amount with Terrence Blanchard. And he has so many sides to his
amazing
palette too. And he's another person up on the podium, very different style, obviously, than John Williams. But he has a way of getting the orchestra to come together and coalesce that's so great. And
wow.
We have some stuff coming up for him. Actually, he's doing a movie where there's some big bandish kind of stuff.
Wow.
Cool. That's awesome.
Yeah, man. So cool, anyway, Alex.
Yeah, I pinch myself every time I get
on.
I've had a great run.
Yeah,
getting to do some of these things and playing with the players and playing the, and what I have to sort of calm down sometimes when you're playing music and any, like if you're doing a record or anything, we're playing this music that's being sight read and played for the first time, and you never know where it's going to end up. You never know how it's going to be, how it might become popular with people and you don't even know it. I mean, a couple times we've done some scores and we're all in the room and we're looking at the picture, like when we did Up. And there was that beautiful scene in Up where they have the family life is what it's called. It's like a little silent movie in the middle of the middle of the film. And
that's a great little piece.
We were all in tears, and it's a great little piece. And
I had a
little solo in it, which I was so, I mean, it was terrible.
Oh, that's you on that. Oh man.
Yeah, it's with a solo tone mute, which is a kind of an old, very nostalgic kind of sound. And it was very, I felt so honored to get to play that little thing. It was so, and it just, you know, and it was just a day at work, and then all of a sudden you walk away and it's been this big, it was a very emotional thing for everybody in that room to play that little piece.
Yeah.
I think it lasts really, it holds up really well and it stands on its own. And one of Michael's genius moments for sure as a film composer, he really,
I was just teaching that, or I have a student learning that piece. He's a beginner. Wow. We're like extrapolating some of the harmonic changes from that Family Life piece, and we were listening to the original, and I'm like, man, all these great soloists on here, and of course it's you. That's great, man. He's gonna get a kick out of that when I tell him, hey, I interviewed the trombonist. That's beautiful, man.
Sometimes you know that show comes up and is performed live now.
Yeah.
Once in a while, because I, you know, it took a couple times to get it really right with the whole band, and I had to keep playing that solo over and over. It was pretty challenging, and it's with that mute and everything, it can be very treacherous. And
sure.
I have trombone players from around the country who have to play that like maybe five times in a run. Ooh. And they go, we hate that solo. And it's great. I only had to do it in one day. I couldn't imagine doing that every night. It's very treacherous. So a week run would give me the
wow, that's great, man.
Terry is chiming in and he says, listening to Alex with a sense of humor, he defiantly would have fit with all the crazies in the Dream Band.
I consider that the greatest compliment ever, Terry. That's great. That's
great. And in the meantime, I found that record of All In. Which tune were you talking about?
It's called Coming Back Home.
Coming Back Home. Yeah, got it. All In featuring Alex Iles. Who's on trumpet?
On this is Wayne.
Oh, Wayne. Ray Brinker, Trey Henry.
Yeah, and he plays on this. And Dave Witham plays an organ solo at the beginning.
Nice. Cool. And Sal is on this as well, right?
Center, yeah.
All right, let's give it a listen. Here we go. Thank you.
I miss playing with those guys because we haven't been doing much with the pandemic, of course. But fun group, real fun group.
Yeah, fun tune.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah,
medley of my hit.
Beautiful.
I find myself I like composing for fun. You know, I could never meet a deadline, but I end up writing something every 10 years or so, and it's been more or so lately, but that's a fun one. But I like that. It was fun to record that tune because it was different from all the other stuff we were doing. Our other stuff is a little bit different. And so it's kind of fun to have that tune. A good friend of mine, Tom Hines, who's a great guitarist, composer, arranger, he wrote a nice big band chart of that for me too.
Cool.
I just wanted to play that when I do guest solo things or
nice.
Maybe it'll show up on one of your concerts.
<Hey-o>. we can talk about that.
I'll bring it for somebody else to play. I don't mind that either. That'd be fun. I'm done.
A feature that's written for you should be played by you.
Oh, I think it's kind of ironic. The irony of me getting to sit in the audience and hear it would be better.
Yeah.
Our little group All In, we've done a couple things that were really fun. We did we're trying to do a little bit different educational kind of approach. All of us do a fair amount of teaching, and what we did as a group was really fun. I think this was kind of Trey Henry's idea. He plays bass with the group, and we went in with a marching band. We had a marching band, and they brought us in, and they were visiting from somewhere. I forget where, but Sal knew the director. And so we set it up. We met at a band room in a high school. Chris Stevens, who's a percussionist and a band teacher down in Orange County, he brought us into the school, and this band was there. And what we did is we talked about improvising as a group. We set up, and we kind of just showed them how we take a tune. Because one of the things about our group is we don't write real. That arrangement was pretty much created by the group. In a lot of ways, it's not, you know, we just kind of, let's do this here. And we're basically all working off a lead sheet. So we're not really, you know, a couple of the things are more arranged, but very often we just bring in an idea. Sometimes it's just like a little fragment and we make up tunes out of those things. It's almost like a garage band. It's really fun. And so what we were doing was encouraging them to kind of come up with ideas that we could play. So we were like their MIDI rig, you know? So it's like, somebody sing something, let's make it work. So it was really fun to get them sort of over that hump of being afraid of thinking that composition or creating music is some deep mysterious thing. Of course it is, but it doesn't have to be right at the beginning. It can be anything. And those humble little beginnings sometimes are the things that get you going. So we were trying to encourage them to come up with ideas, and we kind of improvise and create stuff out of it. And we showed them how we put tunes together that way. And it was really fun because I could see the wheels turning in these kids, because they, you know, being in marching band, especially you play your second clarinet part and you kind of try really hard to make that work. I mean, you don't really have you lose track of the bigger picture. And as far as music education, I think anything to do with helping people to think beyond just their own little world is really helpful. I kind of wish I'd had more of that myself when I was younger. So it was really fun. So that's something we would love to explore more once everybody's back and being in person again. But Trey's very creative in the way he thinks of music. I really everybody in that group is, but Trey's especially, he loves to push the envelope in terms of what he does. He did that a lot with Bob Florence's band. He would always, like, he'd take a straight ahead tune and just play pedal against it, like a whole chorus of just pedal. And Bob wasn't used to that. That was something new for him. And he started going, oh, I like that. it opened him up to some new ideas. And he actually started writing differently a little bit when Trey was starting to play bass with the band. It was really fun. Anyway, nice. So he has that effect on me too. He helps me get out of my head. Forget some of those boundaries that we create, you know, between us and the music.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Trey is great.
Great player. Great.
Oh, so good.
And good at any gig with him. Yeah. Go ahead, Josh.
Oh, no. Well, good in any instance. He's just amazing. You know, I play with him with Tom Scott a little bit, and it doesn't matter what the tune is. It's just, Trey just always makes it feel good, man.
Yeah, he knows, and he's very aware of the people he's playing with. He's very high.
Totally.
I've heard, and it's fun to hear him with different drummers. He plays differently, and
yeah,
so well. I've done Broadway shows with him, and he's the, I like a lot of the time on one side of the pit, you got the brass and winds, you know, and the other side of the pit's the rhythm section. You can't even see them. We go to work, we don't even see each other when we go to work. But we'll have the headphones on, and I'll hear the bass, and I'll go, "Oh, it's Trey." And
yeah.
You know, great bass players would come and go in that chair. I go, "Oh, that's Trey." It's like you could tell right from the first note, just the way he attacks a note. It's so unique. It's like a lot of here it comes back to the West Coast thing. I think maybe this is something that, like, when we were talking about Charlie Loper and Dick Nash having this quality in there that just makes you, that just grabs you. And Trey has that on the bass, and no accident that maybe that's why he lives here. You know, that's an asset to somebody who lives here.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Super
yeah.
cool.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, gents, we've been at it for over 2 hours.
The time just flew by.
Time
wow.
flies, especially with those.
Yeah, my wife says once I start telling stories, there's no stopping me.
Yeah. But I'm fully enjoying it. But I actually have to wrap up because I have another appointment to go to for a change. Actually.
Okay.
But I'm so sorry to have to go. But all of these stories and I mean, so much wisdom that you mentioned to Alex. It was so interesting and so cool to hear all of those stories and wisdom too. And all, and I'm going to check out all of those recordings that you sent, because especially the stuff that is in the email list of stuff that was of inspiration to you. There's some stuff in there that just blew me away.
That's great.
Yeah. Awesome. Maybe we can share that with folks on YouTube and people who aren't able to watch today, because there's some really wonderful things that we didn't get to that you shared with us.
Oh, yeah, some fun stuff. I feel very fortunate to have grown up in an area where there was so much great music happening, and we had good record stores and lots of interaction with some great music. And a lot of this stuff now hasn't been digitized. You know, it's not. And you know, it's great that that we have YouTube and other places where we can hear music, but there's still tons of great stuff that was so influential to me, and it's still sitting in boxes somewhere. You know, so it's just a matter of time, I guess, before people find it.
Right.
Yeah. And nowadays, when that you can digitalize records, that kind of stuff. I know that you do that a little bit.
I do it all the time, because there's stuff that I have on vinyl that I just can't find anywhere.
Yeah.
Digitally.
I have a bunch of vinyl I have to deal with. We should talk sometime.
Hey, man, I got this set up ready to go. If you need something transferred, it's really easy.
It's
I can
a matter
do it.
Of the space they're taking up too. Is, you know, it's probably 1,200 records in there.
Oof, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't even know how much stuff.
I know.
You're talking to some vinyl geeks over here.
Okay, well, I think I might have a good news for my wife then.
Yeah, this record came from Pat Senator's collection.
Oh, okay.
Me and Josh went over and
raided it.
We raided it. Yeah, we literally raided it.
Oh, that's great. And it's a time when those beautiful covers too. You know.
Oh yeah.
Albums. Oh man. I used to just pore over those things all the time, just sit there.
Right.
I wasn't listening to them. I just, you know, had my bowl of cereal in the morning and. Great.
When we started this show, Kevin, the bug hadn't really bit Kevin yet, but it's bit him hard now, and he's buying vinyl like crazy.
Beyond help. He's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can definitely say that. there wasn't a cabinet a year and a half ago just yet. And, you know,
now there is.
Now there is.
And I'll need another one after that.
Yeah. Probably sometime soon, you know, especially with all of those records that I just got from Pat. Those were like,
I know,
50 records or something. Oh,
yeah,
like
good
that.
Shape too. Yeah.
We
need to talk. So
definitely.
And Alex, thanks for sharing your thoughts on just the West Coast know, moniker or the term, and just exploring, just hearing you talk about it was absolutely engaging.
Great. Well, I mean, you guys have been down. I mean, especially if you've
wonderful
been people who know it, who thought about this way more than I have. I mean, somebody like John Anthony Wilson.
Anthony.
Yeah,
I mean, those guys are there, right? In the they're completely in that.
Yeah.
In that scene. So I appreciate the fact that, you know, we were able to talk a little.
Yeah.
That was, because it is kind of. Oh, so one other person I want to mention, Clara Bryant.
Oh, you know, I got to know her before she died.
I knew her at UCLA. She was doing.
Did you?
Some, Yeah, she was doing some graduate work. Actually, she was well into her 50s, 60s. And she was always hanging around at UCLA. I see her. She'd come to all the concerts. She'd always come to our concerts. And I talked to her and found out about her. And what a dynamic,
yeah,
incredible woman. And what a player. And when she was playing a lot and being a woman, person of color, trumpet player. I mean, the experiences she had in life were incredible. And she
really was, interesting personality. That's a really good point about bringing her up.
I love her whole history, and she was great. And so I it's nice that, you know, people like that, it's up to us to kind of keep those names, in people's minds.
That's right.
I didn't know about her.
Part of history.
Oh yeah.
So I'll check her out.
Yeah, she was great. And so that's cool. Well, anyway, we don't want to keep you anymore, Kevin.
No, I'm not in a huge rush, but Alex, thank you so much, man. You're the sweetest and the greatest, and it's such a pleasure to have you on the show finally.
It's a thrill. You guys have followed through and kept this going. It's a really nice thing, and I got razzed by Terry Gibbs. What? How?
What more do you want?
I'll never forget.
Hey, well, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. Okay. And for everybody who's out there, Alex will be playing with the West Coast Jazz Hour Big Band with us on February 17th at Vibrato. That's not canceled. That will still happen. And on February 8th, we'll be back with a tribute to the great John Williams, who's celebrating his 90th birthday on that date. So stay tuned for more stuff. And thanks so much, Alex. You're the man.
And your website is alexilestrombone.com? Mm-hmm.
That's right.
For those who want to kind of follow up and chase you down.
Yeah, sure. Wonderful. Great, you guys. I'll see you out there on the playground somewhere, I'm sure.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah.
See you, Kevin. All right. Take care. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Bye. Have a great day.
You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks for watching, everybody.
Thanks.